Hello, folks. It's now the next day. I had a pleasant night at Colorado National Monument. Beautiful campground, Saddlehorn Campground. Very peaceful and quiet. Voila. Watch that. You'll have to watch that video when we release it. Anyway, had another failed attempt, another behind-the-scenes thing to reveal to you as we leave Colorado National Monument. Started to film another standalone episode. There was a place I wanted to go visit called Rattlesnake Canyon. And there's a gate that's closed seasonally to access it. April 15th, it's April 13th. April 15th through, I think, August 15th or something like that, it's open. Now, Amy and I did research. We were aware of that. And then we used Google to plot a route and see if it would have an alternate route. And Google, of course, plotted an alternate route. Awesome. So let's go do it. And anyway, so I just wasted, I don't know, an hour, hour and a half, maybe, driving. You have to access that place in the back of, Colorado National Monument, and, just encountered a bunch of private land. So Google plots a route to get you there, but the route is blocked off by private landowners. Every single landowner had a gate, no trespassing, and I couldn't access the public lands that way. And I just didn't have time to sit here and finagle with it and try more alternatives, because it could have just been a whole day of failed attempts. My assumption is that gate that was closed is the way in, and probably, for lack of any better understanding, the only way in. Do not make the same mistake we made. Learn from our experience. Don't always trust Google Maps. That's the biggest thing I can teach you, especially when it comes to some back road stuff. I'm sure the road went there, but Google can't know if a private landowner decides to shut off their property line like everybody back there did. So, had to abort the mission. All right, we are now departing Colorado National Monument. Little tear coming out. I really enjoyed that place. It was very special. Very special. Can't wait to see how the footage came out.
No, not right. It's Thompson Springs.
Okay.
And then it's the Sago Rock Art, which has petroglyphs and pictographs.
Okay, cool.
And then further after that is Sago Ghost Town.
Nice. Okay, cool. So a little chaotic, I know, from your guys' perspective. I want you to see all of this, though, because I want you to really get that behind-the-scenes experience of what we do here. So you heard a little bit of a snippet, I think, from Amy there. Hopefully she's cool with it. She doesn't know I was recording some of that, but she didn't say anything bad, so we're good. But you could hear the dialogue, you could hear the teamwork that we have, and she really, in a very short amount of time, came up with a whole itinerary around this place called Sago Ghost Town. However, looking at the current time, arrival times, and what I'm gonna do, because of the wasted time, I've wasted a good couple hours today. That was the cost, so not the end of the world, but I'm gonna head down to Hanksville and Goblin Valley, and rather than take you guys to the ghost town today, it's abundantly clear that place is rich with history and rich with things to do, worthy of its own video. So I don't know what the plan is for us today. We're gonna figure something out fun. Don't worry, we're not done by a long shot, because I'm gonna document stuff each day of my trip. Just look at the San Rafael swell out here in front of me, how magnificent that is. Interstate 70 cuts right through that, by the way. Like, when, you'll see that later on. We're gonna continue
west. Turn
left
onto Utah 24 West.
And, I don't know. To me, it looks like Cars Land at Disneyland, those big rock features out there, which we'll get a closer look at later. But this is one of my favorite areas, if not my favorite area in the United States, the San Rafael Swell.
Continue on Utah 24 West for 24 miles.
Yeah, it's unlike anything, some of these landscapes I'm gonna be taking you through, especially when we head back towards Phoenix. One of my favorite roads in America, and just something that you just couldn't conceive as being possible, like lies out there. But anyway, towards Hanksville we go, in Goblin Valley. All right, so let me just give you a little bit of a plan of what I have in store in this general area. You've been following along, you know, my first area was the Monument Valley area. Then we migrated to Western Colorado, we'll pass through in Moab. And the final area here on my trip, which is several days, is the San Rafael Swell, Goblin Valley. So what I have planned, a few things. We're going to be camping at Goblin Valley in a tent and a yurt. So I'm doing one night in a tent, one night in a yurt, and making a video about that experience, the Goblin Valley experience. Then we have several ghost towns I could explore depending on time. You know, some of these things are hard and not hard to get to, but just take a long time to get to. And then after that, after I'm done in Goblin Valley, we're actually going to pack it up and spend at least one night out in the middle of the swell and just try to plop down in a dispersed campsite. There's several options out there. One of the highlights and what I want to do is something called the Wedge, the Little Grand Canyon, as they call it, which we also visited there very briefly at the end of one video, but I did not give that place its due. And to camp there would be something amazing. So, but if that doesn't work out, there are several other campgrounds back there I have to choose from, and I'm confident we'll find a good one there. So that is, like, in general what I have planned. You notice that there's quite a few things. I think I have more than I can probably get done in this time, and that's the way it needs to be in case one thing falls apart, as you've been seeing. So I had that happen a couple times so far for different reasons.
In a half mile, turn left.
All right, for the final approach. All right, that was cool. That was easy. Yeah, if you're camping here or staying in a yurt, you don't have to pay a separate entry fee. I got another map and didn't really have any questions because I've been here before, but she did say that checkout time for other campers is noon and most people leave well before that. So she says I'm cool to go in there and set up camp. It's really windy out there. You can't tell because this brush doesn't move back and forth, but her hair was flying in the wind. I don't know where this freaking wind, man, like the forecasts suck. But I guess I'm gonna just go take care of setting up the tent because I don't know if it's gonna get any better. All right, so this around this way would be where the campground is. I know site 18 is in the back somewhere. I think it is a one-way loop. I'm gonna drive right by my campsite from last time. I have a bad memory from this place. It has nothing to do with this place, but I actually got the shingles. A random occurrence after a trip out here, and I always associate that with this. That was so horrible. I'm not gonna trouble you with that, but yeah, I see my old site. I'm gonna call it the shingle site. We're looking for site 18, which should be like hidden away back here. I watched my own video, by the way, to pick out the site because I just didn't remember, but isn't it fantastic back here? All of the color and weird formations. There's some other early setter-uppers too. Such a cool place. I think the site is right here. It's a walk-in, you get a parking spot, and yeah, this was what I was hoping it would be. You get two parking spots for the price of one. I guess I can like take up both spots if I wanted. I'll try to be nice though in case somebody else needs an extra parking spot or something like that later. I don't know. All right, folks, we have zero connectivity out here. Gonna continue our road trip, and plans keep changing because I keep learning about so many cool things here that I haven't studied. Got a paper map I bought of the whole swell. Big map here, National Geographic style. And I was talking to a ranger or helper inside the shop, and they were telling me about all these slot canyons. And there's a road called the Behind the Reef Road, where there's a trailhead for something called the Chute Canyon, which I think is a box canyon. And I was told that it's relatively short. And something I think we can do, and there's some kind of like window at the end, I was told. So I'm gonna study up on the map once again and see if we can take you up there. You see that like rising terrain off to the left here? That's the San Rafael Swell, or the start of it, and that's where a lot of these slot canyons and all these cool geological features exist. It all is carved up in there, and that thing extends for a very long way. I was looking at that map in the visitor center. I forget how many square miles it is. I'm trying to see if my map book says it like prominently there, but it doesn't. Anyway, but we're gonna go in there. Oh, wow, just look at that beautiful sandstone and all of the crazy angles. that thing sits on. I love this area, guys. I absolutely love this area. One of my favorite of all time. There's probably a lot of dispersed campground here. There's a campground. It's Temple Mountain Campground West. So maybe that one's for the tent campers. There's the East Campground, and I see a RV there. Wow, really washboardy here. Extremely washboardy, so I don't think you'd want to ride your Harley back here. All right, so I think we're on the right track. I just saw where the campgrounds were on my map. It's fun using paper maps. And I think what I'm looking for, we're gonna go a little ways down this way. I'll know we're going the right way if we see a canyon called Crack Canyon on our left. Chute Canyon would be the one beyond that. Not encountered many people, just that big group camping there and one bicyclist. I've not passed any other motorists yet. Well, speak of the devil. there's one of the motorists. You can see how dusty and dirty it is in the wind blowing. Woohoo! Oh, but just look at this heaven back here, my friends. Look at this heaven. I hope I'm doing right by you guys. If I didn't have Slim, I wouldn't be doing all this stuff, so thanks, buddy Slim. Changed my life, buddy, you changed my life. But yeah, it's kind of cool to get this perspective, because as we were driving in, you saw that more gentle sloping, front-facing part of the reef, what I'm gonna call the reef now, because this is Behind the Reef Road. But on this backside, it's just spectacular looking, like a lot more like sharp drop-offs and stuff. And when I see these fences, I wonder, like, why do they have those there? I guess they just want to block people from coming in here, but I need to keep an eye out because there should be trailheads for things around here, and I really just don't know. I haven't seen any signage yet. It's just fun driving back here. This is true Farfignugan in a Chevrolet. Oh, and the reveals. Look at the reveals and the feels. Oh my gosh, Utah. Utah is the place. Yeah, this road is pretty torn up back here. So I would not recommend this at all for a passenger car at this point. There's some really ugly sections back there that I didn't film, but this looks promising. This little area down here, I see a car parked. Do I see a cow? Or maybe is that a sign? At the very least, I see like a post here, so we'll at least now get to confirm where the hell are we. All right, so this is not our stop, but it's confirmation that we are in the right spot. This is the Crack Canyon Trailhead. Another one that was recommended to me. It's one where I think it has wide open spots, some narrows here and there, and you could do this as a circle with the chute, apparently, and do a loop of it. I think there were some warnings about this one, though. I don't know if it was one of the entry points or something, but probably not gonna have time to explore this one. But I wanna at least show you how beautiful this country is back here. These guys know what I'm talking about, don't you?
Hi.
There's like a bull over there with horns. Is it coming over to protect this one? Usually cows are afraid of people. I don't know, like I've had a bad experience with horses and mules. Well, a mule, I should say. Not a mule, I'm sorry. A donkey or a wild burro getting bit. Do you guys bite or do you guys hurt people? I'm not gonna get any closer. But you don't run away. You don't run away so much. Your friends, usually you run and you run and you run and you just chew and chew and chew. Wanna watch it eat and see how it does things here. All right, I'm gonna leave you alone, my friend. Happy trails. So I wanna say our destination is in between these giant features over here. And what do you guys think about this? My mind is being blown every turn of the corner here. Lots of washes down here too, so you might have some sandy conditions. Haven't really found any deep sand, but you got these steep little ruts because it's been raining a lot. So surprised we haven't seen any water. But I guess we're far enough from like mountains that have snow melt on them out here. And look at how craggly those rocks are in front of us. I think we did it. I think we did it. How you holding up there, Slim? Are you enjoying yourself on this trip?
Glenn, this has been the best trip ever.
I'm really glad you think that. It really pleases me to hear that.
Oh, buddy, have fun in the canyon. Be careful. I'll be waiting here for you when you're done.
Slim, I appreciate you. You're very reliable. All right, so expectations going in that we're going only like a short ways in to see the prime attraction. I did make a rookie error though, and I left my paper map in the car, and I have no connectivity out here, and I don't have offline maps downloaded for this because I was not able to prepare or didn't think to prepare in advance because all of these decisions were rushed in last minute. I bet you around that bend, hopefully we start to see signs of Slot Canyon back here. So this really best describes why this moment, why I like to travel alone, or one aspect of it, is coming to places like this where the sheer size of things just, it does something to your brain to give you humility. But yeah, I feel like R2-D2 or C-3PO about to get zapped by Jawas on Tatooine. Ooh, and there's a sign here. So, what does that sign say? But you know what I mean? Or sand people could just be right up there and do their yurt, yurt. I do a bad version of that. In a way too, you can consider videos like this that are just not really, they're just loosely scripted, like scouting missions that I take you on with me. So that's really kind of what it is. And if I find it's really worthy of doing something more, I can always come back. Wow, this is so neat. Do a reveal here. I think it's gonna twist a couple times. Or who knows, maybe we've already been through the chute. I would doubt it though. Because if you look here, we're coming upon 1,000 footers. Or more, I don't know. And that takes that abrupt left turn into something that looks the most promising I've seen yet. So here's the problem, I guess. I gotta go walk back. That'll eat up time. And then I gotta eat dinner, get washed up, get ready for bed, charge a bunch of crap. But we're gonna peek around this bend and make a real decision. Just around the next bend. It's a joke. But I'm feeling it, guys, I'm feeling it. It's really zigzagging through here too. You see that? It's like meanders fiercely. This is looking like what I would expect to happen if a Slot Canyon is on the horizon and I'm feeling the wind. You're probably hearing the wind. Dude, this has gotta be it, the chute. I'm calling it, guys. I'm calling it, I'm gonna just be brazen about it. Slot Canyon or not though, those curves there are beautiful.
Thank you.
when I decide to turn around, one of you is gonna say, oh, it's around just around the next bend. That should be my life. If I ever have an autobiography one day, it's gonna be titled, Just Around the Next Bend, dot, dot, dot. Oh yeah. Come on. I know you got more than this. This is more meeting my expectations of what I was looking for. So if this is indeed really the chute now, then I imagine it's pretty short compared to other ones. So we might be near the end of the rainbow soon, but this is spectacular. It's different than other ones that I've seen in that these contours and lines are very unique in this one. Wow. Surely this is the chute. And does it get more narrow though? Because once again, some of the other ones, like Little Wild Horse, narrow up even more than this. The walls will really close in on you. The only kind of crappy thing is these things tend to narrow up and widen up and narrow up. So I don't know, but that was worth the walk, I thought, to see that. That was pretty cool. Well, I tell you what, this doesn't look very promising anymore. So I'm going to assume we've hit the chute. There might be more to see. I'm probably missing something good, but I want to get back to the car and try to get some good rays before it's too late. And it's going to take me an hour to get back. It's going to take, like, I'll be there at 7:15, I estimate. It's currently 6:11. So let's cross our fingers that this was the chute and I'm not missing anything, because that landscape really opens up over there. So it feels unlikely, but it doesn't matter because this has been so amazing. And on the way back, I get to enjoy it more because I'm gonna put this camera away, which is a rare thing for me. I'll get out the other camera to just take snapshots and I'm gonna enjoy it for myself. All right, I'll catch with you guys up at Slim back on the road. All right, I'm gonna get us out of here now, or Slim's gonna get us out of here. I can't take all the credit for that. But that was the chute, as best as I could tell. My watch died at the very end, but I did run my fitness tracker on it, and I was over 6 miles, so 3 miles in, about 3 miles out. It narrowed up, and on the way back, in fact, it looked a lot prettier because on the way in, I was rushing and, you know, I was expecting to see another Little Wild Horse Canyon on a smaller scale. And we didn't see quite that, but it was spectacular. So if we find out that I didn't finish it, once I can check my phone or something, the map doesn't tell me distance, or I didn't measure it out anyway. So you never know. But anyway, we're back on the road here. Very overcast now, but I'm gonna pound and ensure get some energy back here, and then we'll hang out at the campsite maybe, or maybe tomorrow at this point. Actually, I think we have done enough today on this road trip, haven't we not? That was like an epic adventure on its own. Jeez Louise, I was out there for like 2 hours, so what do you want from me? Anyway, I'm gonna hang up the phone and get home before I part ways with you here on this road trip day. We're facing the sun now, the sunset over the San Rafael swell. And I bid you good night, and we'll see you on the morrow. You can
can see the sands, the dust blowing on the road below. Think of me in my tent last night. And what I figure I'm gonna do from here is I've got some other videos to tighten up and finish the campground episode, and I also have a yurt tonight. So I'm gonna drive into Hanksville, Utah. If I remember correctly, it might be like a 40-minute drive or something like that. But I'm gonna fuel up so I can fuel up for the next few days of adventuring back here. So I think that's the closest fuel there is to this region. And then I may grab a hamburger, and then I gotta come back here and get the yurt. Really excited about that. I'm really excited about not having to sleep out in the elements here. It's like gusty as all heck today, and it's not letting up. So I had my fill of that one night in a tent that doesn't filter out the dust. No, thank you. I also need to call Amy. I've been out of communication for now almost a full 24 hours. She knows where I'm at and that I don't have coverage, and she knows that I do check in when I can. So I also want, that's one reason why I want to go to Hanksville now, is to take care of that business also. Just get all the business out of the way and get back here, get into the yurt, get settled. And then any spare time I have left over might be another video or us hanging out on this adventure. What is going on here? That's a very, very bad place to pull over. If it's not intentional, if you broke down, that's one thing. But if you just park there, people around here don't have much common sense. How do you guys like the segments, by the way, just in the car, hanging out, checking out the views? I've always been curious, like, does it get fatiguing or is it fun to just see life out the front? I forgot to wash my windshield, but it looks like I washed it at the campsite last night, and it hasn't, there's been no bugs, but we'll see by the time we get to Hanksville if it needs another washing. How many of you guys have heard about the San Rafael swell before? It was unknown to me about 3 years back or so. And now it's, I mean, I would easily say top three favorite areas in the world that I've traveled to, which really means the U.S. I'm doing this by memory. I'm hoping I'm right. I'm pretty sure I'm right. I need to be on Route 24, and I didn't notice any signs yet, so I don't know if I'm going out to Route 24 or turning onto it. But look at this dust storm coming up, like right here. Oh, crap. All right, we are going to drive through a little haboob. I don't think this qualifies as a haboob, though, but it is just blowing dust. All we are is dust in the wind. Wow, this is trippy. I don't know a better word for this. This is cool. Oh, I remember this landscape up here. This is very pretty. These weird, it's almost like Goblin Valley-esque looking rocks that you drive by up here, and with the mountains in the background to boot, you're gonna head for the mountains. There it is, it's like the Burger Shack, that's what it's called. Ooh, I crossed over the Dirty Devil River, so maybe I need to be a Dirty Devil and have some Burger Shack. I have to, man, it's a tradition. All right, let's go get us some Stan's Burger Shack up in here. I'm ready for this. This is gonna taste so good. I've been so deprived. Yeah, it's gonna be good. So I'm gonna try to do something very outside of my comfort zone and eat my Stan's Burger Shack burger here in front of you, because it's a tradition now. This is the second time I've been out this way, and it's the second time I've stopped here, and I remember it tasted so good, mainly because I'm so deprived and just eating like peanut butter sandwiches and bananas and, you know, not eating this. So like, it's that dopamine, that was not mine. Mine's the next one. Sorry, I heard a number, and I'm so looking forward to this. So here's what we ended up getting. I got a large fry, and they're like really nice. They're like battered fries. They're so good. They taste just like I remembered. And then the burger, the Hank's
burger with cheese. And I did a custom order with ketchup, mustard, and onion. And there it is, the Hank's burger. Look at that. Oh yeah. Good, nice greasy bun too. I remember all of these details from last time. After not having anything like this for as long as I have, that's the best thing I've ever tasted. So let's try this Hank's burger here now. It's hard to really describe it just because it's so good no matter what. It would taste amazing. So it's a tradition, and you should stop here if you're ever in this area. Look, I got ketchup in my face. I think I'm gonna sleep well tonight here. That experience is probably the best dining experience that I've had of 2023, probably of 2022 also. Not even joking. Oh, I feel good. Oh, okay, so now that I ate that, I feel like $1 million. That was just what the doctor ordered. I couldn't have asked for anything better at that moment in time other than Stan's, but we do need to call Amy now. So I'm gonna call her, and hopefully I'm not being devious. I'm gonna tell her I flew my drone at Goblin Valley State Park, and let's see what she says. She probably won't believe me. But guess what?
Oh, good.
Guess what?
What?
I made a standalone video of Goblin Valley, and I flew my drone all through it.
Oh, you can do that?
Yes, you can. I got a permit, so.
Oh, that's right. It's BLM. Oh, you got a permit?
Yeah. No, it's a state park. It's a Utah state park. But for you, there were signs I saw. It's like, $10 permit, and you fill out a form, and you're good to go. Ooh. So the video is basically.
And they give it right there.
Yeah, you just fill it out, and then they tear off a thing, and then, pretty much got to fly around. It was amazing. So that was all. I wasn't expecting that. So I did about a half day today, making a video about that, like droning in Goblin Valley. So, and by the way, you're on video right now because I wanted to get your reaction to that and capture it. So.
Oh, great.
I think you said the F word, but you could bleep that out though if you said a bad word. So anyway, I'm going to stop recording now. So, all right, my friends. Amy and I are caught up now on current affairs. The cats are doing well. She's doing very well. I think she's pleased about all of the things that I filmed. I gave her a rundown on a lot of what I've been up to. Really super excited about the drone, because she didn't, I think that was the reaction I was kind of looking for, was like disbelief maybe. I think I confused her, or confusion. You know, to say, oh, I flew a drone in the state park is not a usual thing. And, you know, I do want to make one last comment about that, because I've been, you know, saying, oh, the whole drone thing has made me so excited, and being able to do that, and that is true. And I'm sure there are some of you that despise those infernal devices for their, you know, kind of, they sound like a buzzing insect, kind of. And, you know, I don't have a good answer for you on that, to be honest. I respect what your opinion and all of that. The only thing I might say to try to water it down a little bit is, you know, if you know how fast these drone batteries drain, you would know that they're not up in the air for very long. So, while yes, they can be noisy, they don't stay up in the air that long. I was pretty much in and out each time within minutes. All right, so back to Goblin Valley State Park, where I'm going to get the yurt. There's a couple ravens that they warn you about that like to invade campsites and run off with people's belongings, but this is all right behind where I'm staying tonight, in that yurt. Yes, I'm staying in that thing, which is amazing. There's an amphitheater that I'm gonna assume, like in the winter months, I bet you they do like star like things where they have laser pointers and crap. I love those presentations, but
I don't know that for sure, that's my guess. Or ranger stories, they probably tell you about the land and the history and other things. You know what? This is our own private Goblin Valley right behind my yurt, and I haven't explored it on any other videos, so it's gonna be this video, you and me, pals. We're gonna go look in here and look for like animals and caves. Wow. Here's the shot. Dun 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 dun. This is creepy back here. Oh my gosh, is this like Cathedral Gorge part two? It might be. That is crazy. I've not read about anything. Maybe these are the hidden secrets. I think it is a hidden secret here. I had no idea it would go back this far. I have like Cathedral Gorge in my backyard. And does it keep going and going? I think it does. Look at that. Starts to get awfully dark back there. So I reckon there's probably an end. You can tell people still go in there. But I'm pointing this out to you. So when you come here and explore, I'll leave you one secret and you comment down below and tell me what's back there. It's scary too, just to know that gravity is constantly tugging down on all those little hoodoos and goblins. And this thing's being held together just like dried clay, like baked clay, really hard. But that's how I would describe this best, is like someone made a clay sculpture and baked it, like really super hard. If they have industrial strength, whatever that is, clay, that's what this is. You almost can see like some sunlight on the cloud there. You see that? It's kind of yellowish. This is the weather that you kind of hope you don't get on trips, but then when you experience it, you wouldn't want it any other way. Just because you have very weird weather phenomenon happening with like these weird low clouds, and it really makes for some amazing photography. I just wish the sun would poke through and that would be done. It would be amazing. Now I'm not going to take you inside the yurt on this episode because I want you to be enticed enough to watch the episode where I give the grand tour of the inside and my experience in it. So, you have to enjoy it from the outside. Well, folks, this has been a blast. The most fun I had over this whole trip. Hopefully this was helpful for you to see a little bit of campground life here, yurt life, as well as some stuff here in the surrounding area. Anyway, take it easy, subscribe if you haven't yet, and we'll see you next time.